So as always, we begin every meeting with public comment. We have our rec woman watching us, correct? Soon to join us. We don't know quite when. No comments for us. Our approval of minutes.
I'm going to approve the minutes for...
I don't have mine.
14 and 7. Or 2?
7 and 14.
7 and 14. Dave had some suggestions for those, or additions, subtractions. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
So moved. The chair's report. So we have a new member that we elected to the Community Preservation Committee as of yesterday. And that person's name is, does anyone remember? Who we elected?
David White.
Oh, White. White Ball or something?
And there was also a write-in candidate.
And do we know whether the write-in?
Yes, so there were two write-in candidates, Pennington Geist and Chris Holman, and Chris Holman has Whitely Moore.
So we do have two new folks coming in. Well, that's good news. Great, and we'll be very sorry to lose Marlene and Dave, who will serve for the second meeting in November, right? And then I think that's it?
Yeah.
Is that it?
Do we have any meetings in December?
I don't think we have any meetings planned in December, do we?
No.
No? So we will be out with the old, in with the new. And so we'll lose two and gain three.
We might not be lost, we just will be forgotten.
Never forgotten, but...
We'll be coming in asking for money.
Yeah, maybe coming in.
Keep it down.
Exactly. Really, the only other thing I had was just to make everybody aware that Bob Zimmerman sent a copy of the email that he received to both Sarah and myself, I don't know if anyone else received that, saying they received an additional $10,000 for the grant, which would then bring them up to $50,000, remember, it was an $80,000, I believe, project. $40,000 was a request from us, so that would drop us down now to $30,000 request. The only other correspondence that we got, and Sarah, refresh my memory, did everyone get that? From the DPW regarding conditions on Pulaski Park?
So...
Did everyone get that?
No.
No, sir?
So should we decide to fund Pulaski Park this round? DPW is requesting that we include specific language that would allow them to build up their contingency fund because they've been paying utility costs out of their contingency fund. So should we decide to fund that?
There's a specific sentence, I believe, that was suggested, that would be a condition that would give them a little more flexibility and leeway rather than, again, just funding, putting utilities underground since they're already spending some money on that. That's it for me. So now we move on to our difficult task at hand, of which we have two nights to be able to do this, tonight and 2 weeks from now. We'll see how far we can get tonight with our 2, 4, 6, 8 proposals, is that right? Eight proposals. Once more, Sarah, just so we're operating on the same page, can you give us the lower of the estimates of money? I know the state has not gotten back to us as of yesterday, right?
They have not.
So while Sarah's doing that, maybe it would make sense for us to spend a moment looking over the sheet that she gave us, since this is new to us. And then, as I recall, what we've done in the past is to begin discussion with what came in as the top priority, or more or less that we had a lot of agreement on, and then move on to ones that perhaps we had less agreement on. And there are certain ones, I think, that we have a clear amount of agreement on, and then sort of move through those. We would begin with a motion to fund, and someone could make that, and a second on that if we have it. and then we would have discussion, knowing full well that this is putting the items into the shopping cart, as we say, rather than a definite yes or no or funding amount. We'll sort of begin with the shopping cart, of which we can add or subtract as we move on. One of the things...
And the minimum amount that we would have is $1,016,024, but $145,000 of that is in the affordable housing reserve. So we can't tap that since there were no affordable housing projects. So it's $871,024.
$871,000 is our minimum.
And that's for two rounds?
That is for two rounds.
For this?
Well, two rounds and then plus $145,000 for affordable housing. Because we may get affordable housing projects next round.
Do we want to spend a moment just taking a look at this? Would that be helpful?
Yes.
Like 5 minutes or something? Let's do that.
And I'm not included on this. I didn't send my shipping.
Okay, thank you, Marlene. Just be sure to chime in. How are folks doing? Do we need more time? Everybody good?
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
So we have 5 people sent in sheets then.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so it sounds like Jack and Marlene did not. Is that right? And I assume that David did not as well?
He did not.
Okay. So does it make sense listed in order of highest rank? I'm assuming that average rank of 2.4 for Fitzgerald Lane. So does it make sense to go through in the order that they are given? Correct? Good to go on that? Okay.
We will revisit
everything. Correct. So everything we initially make is tentative in the shopping cart, but not through the checkout line.
Okay.
Correct? Yes.
So I move that we fund $30,000 for the Fitzgerald Lake Boardwalk project.
Is there a second?
Okay.
Discussion.
This seems to have enormous support from a broad range of people and very many people. and hit a lot of points in our evaluation criteria. For me, this came out actually as the number one in terms of collecting points, looking at our evaluation. Seems like a lot of value for the money, and I think that their fundraising shows a lot of commitment and community support, and it seems just the sort of thing that we should be funding.
I agree. I have images of people meeting out in that way repeatedly, trying to make that work as long as they could. So I feel like a lot of people.
Unless there's anybody who has any negative comments.
I do. I think it's a really important project. It's a center piece of our conservation, and they've been doing a great job of keeping it up, and it's clear that they've done everything they can to keep things broken. It's time to move it.
Jack, this has the Conservation Commission blessing?
Yes, and they've done a great job, I think, getting other support, so I'm not just relying on this committee and, you know, looking for money wherever they can, so I have to praise them for that, you know, going all out to get this project done. So.
It just seems like BBC is such a model for other activist environmental groups in terms of their, on so many levels. Any other discussion on this?
I think $30,000 is a good idea, but just for the reason that there's so little money and so many projects. So I think that's a very fair recommendation, and I would support that.
Anybody else want to weigh in on this? We keep this up, we'll be out of here by half past.
Yeah.
Was it half past? So there was a motion on the table to fund $30,000 for the Fitzgerald Lake Boardwalk.
Second.
Oh, I'm sorry?
Oh, second.
Well, there was second. I'm just
sorry.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Remember, this is in the shopping cart. Into the shopping cart. Okay, number two is Pulaski Park Overlook.
We approve $200,000 for Pulaski Park Overlook.
How much was that?
$200,000.
And Dave, second that. Discussion on this?
Can we hear what DPW?
Sarah, I apologize.
Yes. So, DPW indicated that they have been spending some of their contingency funds on some of the utility bearing costs that have started to come in. So, DPW had requested that anything that is awarded this round awarded to, quote, underground utility work or other construction expenses related to construction of Pulaski Park improvements, which would allow them to use the existing grant for construction contingency money for the utility work now and use future grant money to reestablish the contingency.
Okay.
Sure.
What contingency, or is it contingency for their DPW budget, or is it contingency?
That is contingency for existing grant contract under the Pulaski Park work.
So we included it in our prior grant contingency?
It's not from our grant necessarily, but just as a the sum of the whole. So it could be from park funds, it could be from other things. So they had,
Can I restate it in my language? So they've already started spending money on burying utilities, and they've done it from their own contingency money.
So he said at the moment we have $103,000 in unspent funds in the last CPA grant for Pulaski Park, and that's not the borrowing, that's the previous grant.
Uh-huh.
These unspent funds are about 6.7% of the value of the Mountain View contract. Mountain View is the thing that's doing the bulk of the work there. And we're being held for unreceived change order work that may come up during the construction of phase one. However, we're now in a situation where we need to use the park construction contingency money to pay for Verizonville and possible other utility bills that require payment before the phase two CPA grant money will be available, assuming it will be awarded. If the CPC decides to award the $200,000 for utility work in the project, it would be helpful and necessary for the awarding to be such that, and then I read before, that for underground utility work or other construction expenses. And then I asked if we could be even more specific, if that, or that's a concern, to specifically say the contingency, and I think that would be fine as well.
I guess what I'm wondering is, do you have visibility to those trends? I mean, in other words, is this, is someone other than Ned and Jim deciding, I mean, is there some tracking of...
The only thing that they've actually invoiced to date is pretty limited, and it's directly for work on the park, and it's absolutely what the community has approved so far. They haven't submitted this invoice.
I think I'm still not really following them. Are they asking that they be allowed to use these funds awarded tonight to reimburse them for utility expenses that they have already paid, that were anticipated?
Yes, it sounds a little bit like a shell game. We really need to pay this now, and we'd like to get it done and pay it now. And if the CPA funds are awarded, we'd like to replenish those funds.
So I'd rather be as specific as possible so that it can be used to pay future underground utility expenses or to reimburse them for underground utility expenses they will be paid, that were anticipated to be paid from these funds, but have already been paid from other funds, something like that.
Can you clarify whether the place where the monies have come from to date, the monies that were reserved from either CPA funds or park grant funds, or are these coming from DPW own separate departmental contingency fund?
So I heard you say the park grant contingency funds, and you read that.
Not park grant. Okay. So we're in a situation now where we need to use that park construction contingency money. So park with a K, not park with a C.
Oh, park with a K.
So that all of the park construction money is coming from us or the state. The city isn't, DPW doesn't have a budget for the park.
I don't believe so unless it's internal funds that they may be using to contribute to the project, which they may have. I don't know.
The past grant that we gave for $1 million+ had, and everything that we've had, built in a contingency fee. So it seems a little odd that they're asking us to reimburse something that we would have. I mean, it seems like these underground utilities are something that you would pay for out of the contingency, a thing that's unexpected. It came out more. And if we budgeted for that in our prior award, it seems odd that we would be reimbursing something that we've already paid for. That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Except that they probably need a contingency for other items, and then they will have $200,000 from us for utility work, and they'll only have whatever it is, $120,000 more, because they've already.
And so 10% of the plan.
You'll have stranded funds there, unless we.
Didn't we fund $200,000 already for underground utility
yes.
work? Mm-hmm. And so they've spent all that already. Is that it?
That I'm not clear about that. The only thing that I've actually paid out of their $1,300,000 is a $5,000 invoice to Stephen Simpson and a $1,039 invoice around the United States.
But the costs are coming in though at $400,000.
You know what? Sorry, I'm going to interrupt. Someone should be there to explain this. It's confusing. We don't know what they want. And there was no one here at the last meeting to show public support for this. It's starting to live up to my nickname for it. It's the Big D. But the biggest problem for me is that there's so many other projects that have huge support, and they're just small projects. With huge support, and nobody was here at the park, and they're not here tonight. I say they're not fun. I can wait till the next time. I don't think there was even that much support from the public the last time we funded it. It's not like, you know, the historic, the support for the historic projects, the support for Broad Brook. It's just, I don't see it.
Well, I see matching the money for the park grant to get that straightened out, and that's what this is, this piece is about. But what I want to make sure is that they're not, that they do not have, that they have to account for the funds against the monies that we're actually talking about, and it's not going back into a DPW contingency. And if that's what they want to do with it, because they've spent out of that.
And I don't think that that's what it is. I think it's all money for the park. They're just trying to balance where it's coming from.
Okay.
Is what it seems like.
If they're spending money and they are spending it out of a contingency, how come you haven't been getting bills? I mean, that would seem the solution there is send the bills to Sarah. Don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I came prepared to vote for the $200,000 and you feel like Marlene, a little bit of a loss if they don't send someone to explain their proposal to us that they're going to change in the last minute as we're about to vote. It makes it a little bit awkward. And does not give me, you know, confidence that this is being properly implemented. And that might be wrong on my part, but that's how I feel. Like we're supposed to judge on the basis of their wherewithal to get it done. And at every stage, it's been, we've got our contingency, we need more, we need to plan more, we need more, and the price is going up. Kind of get into the little big dig aspect. I don't know what to do at this point. You know, if we can seek clarification or hold up on voting on this aspect or not. But.
Well, it seems like we can. We could request that Jim come in to the meeting in 2 weeks. We could also, I suppose, draft a condition. If we could come up with word, we could fund it if we voted to fund $200,000 in a condition that that we came up with, and we do not have to accept the condition that Jim has said. We can word it ourselves. We can put it to the side for 2 weeks from now. We could
recommend no.
We could recommend no.
This doesn't seem that unusual to me. It sounds like a timing issue to me. They, as part of phase one, they had to do the utility work. They only had $200,000, and they need an additional $200,000 from us. So it really sounds like a timing issue. I don't think it was well communicated, but I don't want to call the whole project into question around that issue. So I would support giving them the $200,000, but asking them to come in so that we can craft the language so that we're comfortable with it for the next meeting.
Yeah, it sounds like they have their budget all finalized and know exactly what's going on, but because of the work that needs to be done now with the utilities, they can't use park funds to repay that, and they don't want to over budget. And they've already budgeted CPA funds, but it's also not a budget, so I'm not entirely sure.
Yeah, I mean, I think all along the park money has been earmarked for something else. Could not be used for burying utilities, and that's why we're stepping up to this, but I don't feel like we ought to do any more on the back of the park until we get the front of the park set. Those are segmentable in
right.
My mind, and we should wait until we're in a better position to do it.
Other thoughts?
I agree with what Linda said, and I really hope that whoever would come really can come fully prepared to talk to us about what they were awarded and what's happening, and you know, because you don't know and it's not your project, and so to have them come and not really be able to answer all of our questions would be frustrating. So they'll be really about this project and about funding and about PA funding. And I also came prepared to vote for $200,000 for the burying of the utilities, and I don't know whose comment this is, but I appreciate that it's here and that they've highlighted it, that you know, we did hear that they were value engineering, but they hadn't finished that. And I think it's wise of us not to fund until they've gone through that, because obviously they'll spend whatever we give them. So, you know, to let them have to figure out a little more what that looks like. And they said that they could wait, so it seems wise in many ways to hold off phase two.
And I agree with Linda's approach in terms of getting information for how we condition it. I think that's in terms of how we package it, if that's the direction we go, $200,000. I made the comment about value engineering, partly for a different reason, which is, you know, if they value engineer away critical aspects of that project and they decrease the landscaping, so all we have is a slope with a bunch of concrete on it, you know, is that going to change our opinion about the value of the overlay? As it is now, I agree with Kevin, you know, get the top done. I don't see necessarily independent utility for $600,000-$700,000 overlook if you don't absolutely have to have it, and that final plan is going to help me make that decision. So that's another reason why I didn't have $200,000 now. And we don't know if we got the park grant, right?
Correct, Sarah?
That's correct. The announcements are already late, but we might know by next week.
2 weeks from?
Yes.
And the only other issue is in terms of how we think about allocating money this round. And we had our discussion, we open it up everything, we try to keep it in the middle, we make decisions about how we do horse trading during our meeting. But if they come back park grant, we're going to be in the same position we were in last year, where they come in the next round and we've got kind of a year to play with in terms of how soon does it come? Do we have to have construction with that grant starting next June? And if that's the case, we'd be in a position where we've got another $225,000 on the table for next round, which means if we're spending more this round, are we going to try to reserve some in the event that they come in? Or do we say, well, you're out of luck because we spent it on other projects that we're ready to go? And I don't know where we go with that. I just wanted to raise that.
So there's a motion on the table, which is to support tentatively $200,000 for the Pulaski Park overlook, for just to go to the underground utilities. There's confusion over the language and what the condition is that Jim set forth. I think all of us want to hear him in 2 weeks. But we have a motion on the table, a tentative motion on the table. Should we be voting on that now?
Yes. Do you want to amend your motion so that it's got this contingency, that the language contingency will be crafted subsequent to the meeting?
Yes. So, well, or do we even need a motion? Can we just pass this one until next meeting?
We can do that.
Or we're putting it in a shopping cart.
We're putting the shopping cart as it is.
Okay. With the contingency language to be ironed out for the next meeting. Okay.
And the second stands?
Second stand.
For that? And we'll get what we're doing. So $200,000 for utilities with contingency to be determined in the future. All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay, so that's 2-4-6-2-1. Is that right? 2-4-6-1. Sarah, did you get that?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Number three, actually looks like it was tied for number two, priority-wise. Historic Northampton, is there a motion to fund?
I'll move to fund it for 131,310.
For 131,310, can you just explain why it's 131,310, or do we wait on that? No, we don't. 131,310, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, discussion? Linda, do you want to explain the 131?
That I believe represents the amount of the Damon and the Parsons house, and it does not fund the barn. As I was looking at this, I was keeping in mind Dave's suggestion that we see if we could get it somewhere. The goal of 50%, I thought it was important to reserve some funds for potentially Pulaski Park. I thought it was important to reserve some funds for the unknown project that may come, project or projects that may come in next time and be able to weigh them against each other. The barn sounded like it needed to be done, but was not as critical. Was the best guess in terms of timing, and so that it could afford to wait that period of time.
So, 131, I'm seeing.
But I did was, you know, I guess, and somebody else did as well. I think it subtracts out the amount for the barn.
Why am I looking at page 95 of our thing?
Look at page 56 of their project.
Okay, thank you.
Dave has a nicely circled at 207,330 for the work in Shepherd Farm. So that's subtracted to the 338,640. The total CPC request gets you the 131,310.
So that's the 92,890 plus the 38,420, is that correct?
Yep.
Okay, thank you, Linda, for clarifying that. Discussion on that?
So I confess to being kind of partial on having flu going across the country. but I see that we can't go down and accept them all, but here is a thought that I don't know the answer to exactly, but the real problem with that barn is in it staying around until we can get to it, which is what I think I would like to do, is there is one very bad joint that is between the ceiling and the wall. And if a little bit of funds could secure that, then I would feel like we've got time on our side. I don't know what that it would take. I don't know if that's a temporary sistering of that joint and it's $500, or if it's a, you've got to go in and really find, replace some things and, you know. So that's my only thought. I agree with you, and I'm going to go along with the partial funding on that. But I just would, my hope is that we get to the barn. I think it's a really interesting structure in the campus there. And it has been, there's been a lot of gnashing of teeth to free up that building for use, and I'd just like to see it get there. And I'm just expressing a, keep my fingers crossed, can we do, what would it take to secure it until we can get to it, kind of feeling.
I'm not opposed to that in concept. I think we tried to ask, you know, are there ways that you could do portions of this, and we did not get an answer that would help me understand what's possible here. So I'm wondering if procedurally we can sort of specifically ask that question and perhaps approve the 131,310 tonight, or put it in the shopping cart, and take up the issue of perhaps an additional little carve-out if we get back some helpful information.
Yeah, I'm not surprised that we didn't get an easy out when it first came up, but now when they realize we really are, you know, it's a margin issue. I mean, ask the fellow, you know, what could be done and see if, I think, is that a fair question for Sarah to ask?
Sure.
Can I, Sarah?
We did that last time with the sewer project. They kept adding things that were a priority, so we did change it up.
I think it's totally acceptable for us to go back to grantees and ask questions. We're doing it with Pulaski, so. My question is, in terms of the Shepherd Barn, $53,000 that's down for archaeology, can we touch it until we do this archaeology thing?
If they're not digging a hole, they don't need to touch that. If there's a way they can shore up the barn and only dig a couple inches or not dig at all, then they don't need to do the joist barn.
Okay. So we could do this joist thing that Deb was talking about without the archaeology.
I'm just winging it, but I think Nancy ought to have the conversation to see.
Well, we tried to have that conversation.
I do.
Because a number of us want to go the direction we want to. And I'm not opposed to asking them to consider it. I'm also not opposed to saying, well, let's make it 141 and saying we're reserving 10,000 to see if there's anything we can do with non-archaeological disturbance to shore those up pending potential further thing. And if they say we can't do it, well, then we get $10,000 back and then we don't have to worry about the clarification. But, I mean, I felt like we were getting mixed messages. I mean, we had a number of mixed messages.
and I like this project, and I came actually prepared to fully fund the whole thing, at least doing this other project, because I think it's important to get that campus done. And I know that it's also a gamble, like, a number of our other projects, we are pretty firm about them having reserves and them having the ability. This one really is the core, and there's no other function like it. And I don't see that we can make that trade-off and lose one part of the investment we've already put into those buildings, but also use that campus, because there's no replacement. And that's why I'm willing to roll the dice and make the big change to their leadership. But, you know, when push came to the shove, we got mixed messages from Nancy when we went on the tour, like, this isn't just apparent, these are too tall at any moment. And then you have the expert come in and said, oh yeah, that's going to stay up for a while. In fact, that's so solid, I'm not worried about the snow, or I'm not worried about this. And so it leaves me at a loss for this. Is it really, I mean, it looks horrible from the inside. It really looks like three of those posts are going to collapse. Yeah. But when they say, you know, we can, if push came to shove, we can go without the barn, and it's not a priority, we don't have to worry about what's inside. I don't know what to do with that. So the clarification might be the best way. But I would firmly support the 131.
Another option is to fund at 131 or whatever without conditions as to what, where that money goes. So they could do most of the Parsons, most of the Damon, and then some in the Butter. It wouldn't have to be as intentional in what we are directing the money. Right.
My only concern about that is there has been such an emphasis on completing areas of these houses so that new collections run out. I feel like I'd like them to stick to their plan. This is the closest we've had to a structured sequencing of what needs to happen. And if they're kind of battling back and forth, then who knows what the consequences are for new things. That would be my concern, not for events.
I just assume complete a couple of the buildings as well. I think they have come a long way. I think their programming is been pretty fantastic. But it's still all dependent on primarily one volunteer individual. And
I drive across the state to get here.
So if, you know, for some reason, she can't continue with that and things start to fall. I'd like to have a couple of houses complete and maybe the barn project doesn't happen. I'd like to see it happen.
Right. Would who make the motion?
I don't know.
Would you accept an amendment to 140 and that would just be a marginal amount and we would, on the condition, say it goes for the two houses with funds to temporarily stabilize the barn?
I'd actually really like to know what they think they can do.
Okay.
I would support giving them some additional money, but I'd really like them to think about it and come back with costs and
okay,
description of what they think that's going to accomplish.
Sarah, would it be okay to ask you to get with Nancy and ask her to get us a cost on just stabilizing the barn in the most minimal way?
Sure. So not referencing a specific dollar amount, but just saying what's the minimum of the
let
pay
to tell us what you're going to
I don't actually have a problem saying we were talking in the vicinity of $10,000, but that was uninformed.
I feel like the engineer that's working on it is a straight up kind of guy, mm-hmm. And I think, you know, I think to stabilize it is the right kind of verbiage, and you know, I don't think he's going to do anything to harm the boat, you know, to make it non-historic. Mm-hmm.
It would be stabilization without the needed archaeology.
Yes.
400 to stabilize it if you had an archaeological dig.
Is there a way we could put a condition requiring Devin to haul the barn to her house? Didn't seem like it was a big deal the last time, Devin. So
it sat in my yard for a couple of years.
Take one for the team, for the town. Tony, Jack, comments?
I think it this is a great project. I came ready to fund it fully because of the community support, and I think what it's doing is it's actually leveraging a whole organization. You know, the focus on the property is changing the character of that downtown, you know, that historic Northampton. So I think it's a very important project, but if with any construction project, there is time, it seems like they'll get started this winter on some of these projects. I don't think they will complete the project, so they may be able to come back in the next round to say, now we're ready to do a final piece. So I think if we're worried about coming out money-wise to a place where we can spread it around, it makes sense to pare down the construction part and let them take the next step. It's going to take time anyway.
This is a great project. It's really impressive. The community support, I think the programming is amazing, sounds great. I have similar concerns that they've done a lot in a year and a half. One of our criteria to evaluate is that they've provided assurance of the ability to maintain historic resource over the long term. I think it's too soon to think that that's even possible. And, you know, they're coming in pretty much asking 95% or something of the money from us. So I do have that concern, and I think I want to fund this. I think even the barn will create community space. This town actually is lacking in community space, and that's an additional wonderful resource. I'm really impressed by what I've seen over the time that I've sat on the board, just over the last year. I wish we had more money. So I definitely came in saying not the Shepherd Barn at this point, and I would sort of anticipate they're going to come back in this second round. But I like the idea of stabilizing the barn without...
Is there a chance for state money for some kind of grant or something? Is that somebody made a comment that there might be matching funds for the state?
It sounds like they pretty exhaustively explored that.
There doesn't seem to be any.
No.
Although they did say that they only recently learned of the historic aspects of that barn. So, I guess it would be possible if they don't get it from us, that they might be motivated to look elsewhere for that restoration. And they did when we turned down the mapping project, and they got that covered when they applied.
It seems to me like it's a chicken and egg proposition, and this organization needs this property to galvanize the community support for historic Northampton, and to ask the community to do the rebuilding in some other way as a fundraiser wouldn't seem possible until they have the assets of these historic buildings. So it seems like we've got to kind of step out a little bit and fund this, and then the community support will get even stronger. So if we could find a way to do the couple of the buildings, you would see a growth in the buy-in from the rest of the community, and perhaps they could do some outside fundraising for the barn too, as they increase their membership.
If we look at starting at page 3, it says some committee members may ask why we don't see funding elsewhere without returning to Community Preservation Committee. So that on 3 it says why we must approach CPC again this year. If you turn the page, context, limitations of other funding. So Jack, to go through some of the stuff they've been looking at, some of these other granting. So clearly it seems they are have done their research in terms of trying to figure out how to get additional funding.
But I think their membership would provide more options as their membership grows, and to grow the membership they need these buildings, they need these structures.
Yeah. That's the tripled their membership in the last year.
Yeah, it's going to go on and up and up.
I don't disagree with any of that, and I think, I guess as we were talking, I thought MCPC is community money, so this is the
community
paying for, for this community resource.
Not from membership sources.
Right.
I can compare to the whole thing, but I mean, two of you raised really important points. One is we've got
one contractor who would be working on all three buildings, and, you know, based on what they've done with the buildings already, it's not going to be possible to do them all at once, so they would probably be staggered, and we may have 2 years under the contract to do it. And so sequencing the way we're contemplating doing two and have one come later might be the natural way that it would dovetail anyways. And then I also agree with you just in terms of kind of a compromise with that kind of feeling of there's a difference here qualitatively in terms of their reserve funds and the capacity to ensure the long-term perpetual maintenance of this. I don't know that it's a guarantee as we've seen elsewhere, but as part of that gamble, I'd rather take that gamble on two parts than three to give them the opportunity to prove this new board is capable and they can't build the reserves and they can build membership.
Because they said they're out of the red, and that's impressive. I'm sure that's partly for our help. And one of the things the contractor said when he was here was, you know, there's, I don't know exactly what he said, but sort of mobilization costs, like the cut. So just as you get going, you just keep going and you do it all. And so there's some expense. And so I would be interested in hearing from them, in addition to the stabilizing and what that would take, and could they do it without triggering the archaeological dig? You know, does that actually play into this? Because I just don't have that sort of construction knowledge to know what is he talking about? You know, that is that really a factor with the barn, that somebody would be coming just to do this, this, and this, and it'll be $10,000 more expensive if they have to come back a second time or something.
And Tony, you're suggesting that Nancy or somebody or the contractor come in 2 weeks from now as part of this?
That would be great.
Yes. Marlene, can you have a chance to speak to this?
Well, I really love the barn, but we need to conserve money, so it's only fair to. And I do recall them telling us that if we couldn't fund the whole thing, that they would put the they could put the barn off. I do remember that it was acceptable to them. I don't think the barn will fall down. They can come back next year. I would really like to take it, but we just have to say no to some things. But we'll put, you know, we'll be recommending bonding for millions of dollars. So it's good to, I think this makes sense. So I'd be in favor of putting the barn up.
Any other discussion? So the motion on the table is 131,310, is that what it was? Are we ready to vote on this? Are we voting, Linda, with the condition that it be used for not the barn? Is that, was that part of your proposal?
Yeah, that it be used for the two houses.
The two houses only, and not the barn?
Yes.
So we're clear about that? Yes?
Are we gonna try to get questions answered about stabilization of the barn, or?
I think that's independent of this vote, but yes. I think we're on track. We're all in agreement to ask Nancy or whoever the contractor dude was to come
Thompson?
Back.
Is it, Chris Thompson?
Yeah, so this can be changed next meeting.
Correct.
Additional information.
Yeah, it might be nice to have some written information in advance, mm-hmm. even if you would like them to comment.
And the written information has to do with the barn stabilization, is that correct?
Yeah, I don't know that I need them to come. I just would like something that would give us a point of stabilization of the barn, just to know what ballpark that's in.
So he doesn't have to come, but he could, in his written material, also address, I think it was the economy of mobilization. If there is some significant impact around the barn site. And I guess I should just put on the table. I'm willing to be swayed. You know, we don't know what our full funding is, and I just would like to hear a little bit more. But I'm happy to go ahead and vote on what's on the table now.
Any other discussion? So 131,310 for historic Northampton two houses minus the barn. Is someone giving us some clarity on the stabilization? All in favor? All opposed? unanimous. Moving on to number four, the Rocky Hill Connector acquisition. Is there a motion?
Motion to fully fund.
Is there a second?
A second.
Okay, discussion?
I think this is a pretty high priority. I know when these kind of parcels come up, I feel the need to just grab them, because the way real estate goes, it may not be there at another round. I just think that if we could get this piece, it would have a big impact on the surrounding parcels that we already own, but also in the, as it was identified by the people from the wildlife refuge, that it's has a significant impact in a much greater area. So it's an opportunity that is not going to wait.
I was really impressed with what Larry Sanders told us about how old of a plan this is, how long ago they identified this as a necessary parcel to connect the wildlife, the access for the wildlife. And I've actually seen wild animals cross there in the middle of the day. And I went to look at the parcel with Wayne Biden. I think it is really important for the wildlife that are leaving the Arcadia. Because I think Barbara's, I never forgot what I saw that day when I saw the a young coyote crossing in the middle of the day. And every time I drive by, I think of this request, and I can see how important it is, because what will happen is when they cross there, if there's a structure in the way, if there's some kind of a building, if there's fences, it turned back into the roadway. So I think it's very important to leave it open there so that they can get across, because it's already starting to build up there. So I hope that we can fully fund it.
Sarah, the land grant that was applied for is not coming yet, correct?
That is not. It will come the same day as the park grant.
So we don't directly with the deal. And so that would reduce our funding from 90 to 55, is that right? Yeah, that makes sense. So the 55,000 if the land grant came in, we theoretically know that 2 weeks from now. Other discussion?
I'm not a huge fan of this in terms of the here and now, and some of the other balance that we're making. And I also, and I got a couple of reasons. One is a wildlife biologist. You know, we acquired a huge number of acres just adjacent to us that's, I mean, connected. And part of the rationale for that, in addition to the bike trails, they would provide wildlife connection. Here, we asked Wayne what wildlife would benefit, and he couldn't tell us which species. And he said, Mass Audubon would answer that question. And they didn't answer that question. They came in, and their ecologist said there were large animals that abused us without any specificity. The report that they gave us demonstrated that the species actually aren't on this parcel, but adjacent parcel, and they crossed through some of the woods and, you know, that's for, you know, some rare species. I just feel like it's a lot of money. And a lot of answers. There's no demonstrated immediate threat of development for that parcel that anyone has said. If they came back another round, we might still be able to fund it then, and give you a better explanation. And just, you know, that area of the road is so heavily developed. There's a junkyard on the other side, and you've got cars, and you've got plenty of other instructions. And we did acquire that parcel on the other side of the street where if wildlife are coming down. I'm a firm believer in green infrastructure, and I totally understand the migratory patterns, but we've already acquired a parcel to serve that function. I can see why this is complementary. I just don't see why it's essential and essential now, given, you know, $9,000, that's half the barn, or it's a number of these other larger scheme of things, I would fund it. I just wouldn't prioritize it this way.
I'm wondering though, since we need to spend $145,000 or reserve it for open space, whether if we didn't fund it, we would just end up kind of saving it and not be amplified with the other open space, I presume Fitzgerald Boardwalk. Sarah, that counts towards open space?
Actually, the last part counts too.
Oh, Pulaski, you're right. Right. Well, get that.
I wasn't sure. I actually tried to do some of that math, and I wasn't sure because some things were given to us in two categories. I mean, there were certainly proposals here that claimed to be in more categories than I guess we agreed with because of what you gave us to work with. And then I didn't know how to work with that 145. So with this one, I took 45 into open space, and they were also on the recreation, so I put 45,000 there. But I have similar thoughts around, are we spending it, are we not?
But I forgot about the last one.
Yeah.
Generally, if it's split, we have the ability to allocate a percentage in terms of reserves.
Yes. Although open space and recreation is the same reserve, so it could be symbolic, but wouldn't be much of a difference.
So even by splitting it that way and putting everything that I had in open, it was still, the ask is 135,000 greater than 145, you know, so that it's well beyond with Pulaski and Bolton.
Is there people here from Audubon, Mass Audubon? Do you keep asking us to fund this? I mean, how often do they come in? And they explained how long they've been waiting for this. It's just, I just think we need to think of that. And also, there's the animals are going to say, oh, look, we go over here. You know, they bought that. That's the route. They just run out into the road and, you know, and they're going to turn back if there isn't another open space that they can run through. And I just think we need to think more about wildlife. It's just always about us. You know, it's always about the people. Like we built in Broadbrook, we're building a bridge for us. You know, there's nothing in all of these applications that's for wildlife. And it's me, what's wrong with this planet is that it's all about the humans. And I've seen, like I said, I've seen the wildlife crossing there. I've seen the coyotes, and I'm sure that the deer cross there, and they'll get hit by cars if they're running, they're slamming into buildings and fences. But I think the most important part is that how long this has been part of the plan. And Mary Sanders spoke in favor of it, and people from Mass Audubon and people from Arcadia, you know, they said, please fund this. I ranked it on my sheet, which I didn't pass in. It was my number one project.
Oh, Sarah, it's so business park.
It is.
And the proposal says that pretty strong language. It will certainly be developed in the future. Do you see a risk of development coming quickly?
It is ledge. If sewers should run down Route 10, I would imagine it would develop pretty quickly.
And what are the chances of sewer running down Route 10?
That'll happen. It doesn't make sense not to have a connection between the two communities. It's an expense, but it will likely happen.
And Jack, it says that this acquisition is the Conservation Commission's top open space priority at this point. Mm-hmm.
It's like you said before that it's part of our overarching strategy of the Wildlife Connector plan that's been around for a long, long time. So it's not, you know, some outlying piece of property. It's part of a bigger picture that kind of completes one section of the acquisition. So, but I can remember it was Mary Ford, maybe Mary Higgins, Mary Claire Higgins, they were proposing the industrial park down that to extend the tax base. But, and I don't know the plans and at the current point, but I think it would be great to secure that.
I agree with your approach. I don't like to play Russian roulette with parcels of land. You never know what's going to happen next.
Go back.
You've got the opportunity to acquire it. I would support it.
Well, my position is that if it's worth acquiring, if we demonstrate that it's of use, and again, we've got the adjacent property already acquired. In terms of the wildlife value, when Lane was here, we asked him that question. He said it's not because of what happens on the road. He said animals are going to cross one way or another, regardless of what happens. He also said he'd be willing to have a housing lot or two along the road to pay for it. So in terms of its value as a crossing, that's, you know, we throw that under the box. He said the main value is the upland part of the parcel where it might be developed. In that respect, you've got land around it that's already been protected to some degree. I mean, I understand the concept, not for me, not the right time.
You know, it always brings up an interesting issue when we for me to second guess the Conservation Commission in terms of them establishing this as a top priority. I always feel uncomfortable doing that. So I would strongly support this as well and share some of the issues about wildlife corridor, and if we're actually parceling off a single family house, which I suppose is part of the possibility here. Does that negate some of that? But nonetheless, I think it's an important acquisition as determined by the Conservation Commission, which Jack has indicated is the case. Is there additional discussion on this?
I just want to add that I don't know how you guys come at this to rank things. These sheets are really helpful in highlighting things that we should be measuring against, because there's a lot, and I'm certainly not an expert in these fields. And I appreciate your comments about the Conservation Commission identifying this, and we talked about that in terms of updating our plan, that we're respecting what's been identified. But I did create a system of looking at this, marking it, and coming up with points so that I could, you know, come in here, because I think we had a lot of fantastic projects presented to us. And in terms of just that scoring and looking at it, that I did the same for all of them, this came up number 6 out of 8, and I was surprised because I liked this. I heard the attorney say, I've been waiting for this for 20 years, it comes, you snatch it, you know. I was surprised that the more uneducated human response about the Feel Good project was stronger than how it was scoring for me. So I'd love to know if they get the other grant, and this is really a $55,000 ask. I'm undecided.
Any other discussion? So the proposal was to fully fund $90,000 for the Rocky Hill Connector acquisition. Are we ready to vote? Knowing that it's a tentative thing. All in favor? All opposed? All abstaining? I'm sorry, was that opposed?
I'm opposing the
next. Okay, so that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to 2. So you got that?
Yep.
Great, thank you. Moving right along, the Mineral Hills Habitat. Recall that came into our small grants, and we booted into the big grants. So here it is.
I move that we fully fund the $3,000.
Second.
Discussion.
Can someone? It's just poor memory on my part. But what were we doing when we booted it into this round? What was the
We had concerns about whether or not this was going to be the planning department's or ComCom's regular approach, that we would see multiple small grant applications from basis features, or whether they would bundle it along with their priorities so we could see it all as a holistic. and then said, he's happy to work with us. So I would encourage all of you come December to work with Wayne and figure out how to do that.
Well, I was encouraged to hear that there was still some funding for Lori Sanders, and I think she's having assessed the properties. I think she has to be involved in prioritizing. I'm sorry that that wasn't a step taken in that first cycle of getting through the assessment, but I'm not surprised either. It's the same problem we have. You know, trying to put them all in order when they're not all of the same apples and oranges.
I think one of the comments too that affected me was saying that for a very little bit amount of money right now, we could have a big impact on this lot. If you wait a year or two, all those trees are going to grow up and you lost your chance at any kind of open space in meadows and potential farming, whether it comes or not. It makes the land much more useful if they can clear right away. So a small amount of money leverages a big effect.
That's true, I agree with that. I have some invasives on my property and it's just amazing how quickly they grow. My neighbors have some invasives. So I would support it for that reason. It is a very small amount.
And it just seems like a prudent investment to me. I know you're troubled by them not having quite figured out how they're going to use it, but I don't see that. And I can understand why they haven't figured that out, and I think this coming forward regardless is going to be beneficial to the parcel. I think the money will speak.
That would be much well spent. And it gets to Maroon's comment about, is it wildlife, it's largely attached to its wildlife beneficial. Lori Sanders' report talks about it, her proposal and her recommendations about creating grassland for birds and wood turtle, but the alternative that's included as well, we might go this way, we might go this way, it might be mutually exclusive, it might not, so we don't know exactly what we're getting, but either way, as a habitat management technique to preserve your options for the future, it's a small amount of money that gets you where you go. I would rather see it go towards wildlife than DPW's tree farm.
Is that a condition that you would set on this?
Personal problem.
Other discussion? Ready to vote? All those in favor? All those opposed? It is unanimous. Connecticut River Greenway parking. And it says parking and sign. Parking pavement and paving in the sign. Is there a motion?
I have a comment.
Let's do a motion first. How about? Somebody get that enthusiasm.
It's actually
a tough one. $50,000.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Marlene, your comment or question?
Well, I don't know. I'm not convinced that this is a real, that the public is taking advantage of this. It still has a flavor of a private club to me. So I wouldn't fund it at this point.
So Sarah, there's been no official opening, or correct? I mean, is there?
No, so North Hampton Youth and Community Rowing is using it as their home base. It is open to the public from dawn until dusk, but it's still being used as a staging area for Lane. It's a mess in some ways. It won't be for long, so they haven't had the big kickoff ribbon cutting type thing yet.
And I don't think you would know it's getting used unless you went down there. I mean, I've been twice. Both times I was using it, and there was someone fishing one time. The other time, the coach was in the Quonset hut doing things. So there was somebody down there both times I went down there. I can see why they're not pitching it yet, because it feels odd to go there. But we put it, it's a really nice ramp down to the water. And I was just in, it's a sidebar, but I was just in Chattanooga, and what they do with their river is what I wish we do with our river, which is just embrace it, put parks all along it. It's, you know, it's a very different feeling. So I think we've already made the decision to invest in that park. We, you know, we've built the longboat ramp, we built the ADA path down to it, we've done some paving, and I guess my feeling is it would be penny wise and pound foolish not to finish the paving project.
The paving project was 45 of the 50, is that correct? And the 5 was for the gate sign thing?
I would say most of our questions of them were about the sign and weren't about the paving, because I think that was a no-brainer. They just didn't agree for each other. And I don't know, but I would say, I'm not sure whether 3 more inches next year wouldn't do it also. I don't know that. I mean, I'm sure there's some degradation over the new season, but.
I think when this came up originally, and we've had this come in twice now, this is the third time it came in, and there was a question because it was expensive to do the 2 layers. The first one, we got to start and figure out where they're going to go and make it usable. But the lifespan on that, I believe, was like somewhere between 15 and 18 years before it really starts to get into disrepair where it's not functional. And so in terms of the next year or two, then we were willing to kind of punt back down the road to see what developed, to see how it would be used. My perspective is, you know, if it's going to be something that we embrace and is going to be a kind of centerpiece on Connecticut River, it would be useful to make that investment. As to the time of that investment, I don't know that it has to be done now if we're in a proposal or something. It's not, again, for me, a high priority compared to other things. I'm a little troubled that we haven't had the public engagement, and I agree a little bit with Marlene, there may be a perception, at least, that this is a private place where people don't know about it. Moving the gate does nothing to raise people's awareness unless they're going down to visit people who live in the condominium or the apartment building. You wouldn't have any independent desire to go and look down that seemingly private road because it's land construction. That doesn't do it. It's functional. If you want to drive in, you can go on the pavement that's there. That was our bargain when we struck it last time, but it's going to be usable. They put up the boathouse. I don't know that I necessarily do it. That's a match for the additional money. Because it seems to be we're paving over something that came into city hands, not into the private hands. That's a convenient way to say they're splitting costs. And I agree, they have been a considerable amount of time and fundraising and everything else. I would feel more comfortable in terms of CPA dollars waiting until they've had public engagement and find out what those public programming is to get people out in rental communities or other things before we put money down for paving and gate.
Well, I know I was disappointed that I missed the, they had rolling for me, you know, every week all summer long, and I just didn't catch the start of it. So, I mean, they are running some public classes in addition to their own rolling club. But it's fair for them to count that fundraised money. And that's when this first started, that's what we told them we wanted them to do, and they've done it. And in some ways, I hesitate to, if we know we're going to try to finalize a project, to have them come back round after round until we finally get money seems somewhat rude, but I think that's kind of what we're saying, is that this is a really tight round.
But I feel also, if we knew it, I mean, the public programming goes beyond Well, which is what their specialty is, and to canoes and kayaks and handicap access and all the other kind of true programming that everyone can benefit from the parcel that we as a city acquired for public use, not for use. And so until that kind of comes through, I feel like it's premature to say, let's pave over our spaces for our, let's pave it over for everybody's use when we have
it. Yeah, it would make more sense to have the rec department more involved. That would be, you know, a great project, you know, summer activity for people in the community. But also, I really don't think they could get it paved right now. They wouldn't be able to pave it until summer, because I just tried to hire some people to do some paving for me, and they're booked. They're solid with all the, there aren't that many paving companies. All booked out, so I don't think they can do it till the summer anyway.
The proposal says, if we're not able to install the wear coat, the lot will have a much shorter lifespan, and we'll need to replace entire existing binder coat. Two coats of asphalt are critical for the full life, and failure to provide will lead to more expensive premature failure. So are we not worried about that yet? I think that you were speaking to that, and I'm still confused about that.
Yeah, I mean, we have to go back to their original application where they laid out the two, and this is another one. When we came in to do it, it's another one of these. Well, we might use it this way, we might use it this way. It's kind of in the alternative. You can either pay it now, or you can pay it later, and here's the difference in terms of longevity. And you know, I don't think it was like a, we're going to pay it in a couple inches, and it's only going to last a year or two. It was definitely, you know, 10, 15, 20 years before things totally degrade. Well, you know, you go back, you know, you attend the voters, folks want to do it. I would encourage folks to look at the application, and I might be wrong about the dates, but that might give you some comfort. You know, potentially, for Sarah, if you want to look that up.
Sure. Was that in the first one or the follow-up?
I can't remember, honestly.
I thought this one said 8 to 10 years.
This one says we would need to replace the entire existing binder coat within the next 10 years. If the wear coat is not put on.
On the last request, they came in for $20,000, and they had $10,000 basically, and that's we did not fund that.
Kevin has proposals from the last 30 years on her.
Yeah, I was just gonna say I think timing is an issue too. I thought there were more comments about the gate, and I think there's a good reason for that, because I think, you know, money spent on the gate would really give them some benefits to just opening and closing at regular hours and getting people down there, and I think that might be a more appropriate. I would like to see just a $5,000 amount given to them for the gate, and then look at it in the future when the timing might be better and it's not as competitive on the proposals. But I think $5,000 would be a great of use to them for that gate situation. Sounds untenable. I mean, they don't know who's got keys and when it's going to open and who else is going down there. Sound like a lot of confusion around the gatekeeping.
I was certainly confused.
Well, they were like, well, we could put it here. Oh, you're right, we could put it there. I thought that was very confusing. Jack, you feel that the gate enhance public awareness, or and allow more people to come in?
It would increase the use of it just by making it easier to use, not having it an attractive, functional gate would seem to be.
That says no trespassing.
Yeah,
this is weird. One says no trespassing, the other says public park.
It's like the jail, you know, the steps of that condo where they had all these in and they wanted CPA funds to build the steps, but it's not very open to the public. It's just, I don't understand why there is a case.
Sarah, do you know if they plan to put a kind of a sign up by on Damon Road where the Lane Construction sign is saying?
There is one now, it's very small.
And it says Rowing, Northampton Rowing.
No, the park sign is actually a bit smaller.
Oh.
But I'm not sure if they have plans to do anything else. I think once the lane issue gets resolved, that there will be a lot more flexibility there. But until then,
I feel some way akin to Jack on the $5,000 versus the $45,000 for paving in terms of making people feel comfortable knowing that you can go in there. What I heard from folks is that not only are we confused, but you got three different landowners with three different perspectives, moving the gate doesn't necessarily resolve their internal conflict. But I could see potentially giving a $5,000 gate and signage subject to, you know, either our approval of planning offices, approval of the language on a larger sign further down the road, and then a contingent on a written agreement between the parties as to their expectations. You know, something that's binding that could be recorded as to how that gate would operate, so that if we spend money on it, it would be used and everyone would be on a level playing field, it would be an issue.
I was surprised that they didn't come in with a small grant for this, for the gate, you know, some $3,000. They took advantage of our small grant program.
And it might be an appropriate thing to do in a future round. But to me, it's like, some of you weren't here when we had the river run application from Wayne for the community garden. There was a conflict between the board of directors for River Run and some of their residents who wanted a, you know, a larger organic gardening space. And the folks from River Run weren't willing to grant access down to the parcel that would be managed. I think the ultimate vote was that we weren't going to do that. They should come back once they hammered out their differences. And to some respect, that's how I feel about the gate. Like, that would be the more appropriate way. Show us how it's going to be managed and then ask us for the money as opposed to put it up. But I can see that we could condition it if folks wanted to do it that way too.
Well, I just think it's too confusing and too tentative and not, you know, to give them any money at this point. We don't even know.
Well, but as a reminder, we already have $190,000 in the project.
So why put another $5,000?
You know? My common idea was to do the $5,000, and I think that just going ahead and doing that, that would give them the impetus to resolve with the condition that they've got to work it all out and satisfactorily. Before the funds can be drawn down. That will give them the impetus to actually do it, get that taken care of, and get it more fun with them.
Part of it, I agree with, that you can't pay right now.
And the condition would say work what out?
Yeah, that's what
between
I
Between Lane, who's the third player, sir?
Lane? I forget his name, but there's an interim landowner in the middle. So it sounds amenable, but
and what are we asking them to work out? That's why I was so confused.
Well, according to the application, they said that the folks at Lane may sell, in which case you'd have a new person or a new entity that would have essentially different interests in keeping things open or closed. The folks from Lane haven't been 100% consistent in when they are opening the gate, and then this other individual is maintaining that it should be closed at different times. So it sounds like on many days it's open when it should be, and on some days you arrive and it's not open, and then there's kind of like the phone tree and who's calling who to see if it's open. So until everyone's on the same page as to when it should be open and who controls the keys, it seems like moving the gate's just going to move the problem further up the road.
It's a waste of money. It's a waste of $5,000.
If it's on, but maybe I misunderstood. I understood the gate was on some land that had the public had been granted access to them. If that's the case, can't the gate just be opened and unlocked?
Right.
How is it granted public access if it's locked?
Yeah. What do you need a gate for?
Well, because of the River Run concern that we're creating a place at the back of their residential area that people would abuse, quite frankly. It's at dusk and dark and night, you know, it's a very tucked away place at the back of that road.
Yeah.
So the gate is locked to keep that transient traffic out of there.
That makes total sense, and that would be something that the city could be controlling as they would any recreational facility. But I thought the issue was with the private landowners, and that's what I couldn't reconcile with the grant.
Well, that was the other question. It was like, you know, what did the deed say and how was it interpreted? Should I have 24-hour access or not? And that's what I expect them to work out. But
The legal issues with the access are all set, but with the gate, it would be a little more complicated. So the city and also the public, if that's what the city wants to allow, has the right to access the park anytime that they would like to. If the city wants to cut off public access at night, which is frankly a good idea, then they have the right to do that. But there's no agreement about who's going to be opening the gate, who's going to be shutting it, what the procedures are for that with the key.
So, sounds like we need more information. So my understanding was they were, part of this was to take away the gate at Damon Road that says lane construction, no trespassing, to kind of get that message off the face. And then to put this in my, what I'm remembering is to not have dumping. And I don't know if it's just, so you can't drive in, and maybe you could walk in, you know, or you can get to a certain point or bike in, or I don't know. And I'm not, I guess, you know, I'm not going to hide that, I just don't know here. I'm not clear on, it sounds like we're saying, well, what have they done? And by they, we're saying the people who are coming in, Northampton Youth and Community Growing, I mean, it's, I don't see it's their obligation to invite the public, unless there's some caveat that I'm not aware of. If it's a city land, then the city's failing to, you know, people will know. I knew because of the write-up about the money that the CPC had granted. And I was like, wow, money, river access, fantastic. But that's the first and last I heard of it besides being here. So I'm not, you know, I don't want to hold them to some standard that's, you know, it's not, I don't know if that's their responsibility ultimately. But I'm, the other thing that's in my head is, you know, we just have this ridiculous torrential downpour, and I just don't know what that does to unfinished paving. I don't know. And I hear what you're saying, and I would like to look back at it.
So, in light of that, I'm like, when the city starts to involve the rec department and involve the community, then I feel better about giving money. But they haven't done that yet. So, you know, and it's not really clear to me what the plan is here. So that's, to me, even more reason to say no, is what the city hasn't done yet.
Can I give you a different take on that?
Yeah.
I mean, in the same way that we asked Broadbrook Coalition to be the actor, I mean, I think this club, now, admittedly, it's a rowing club. It's not, you know, it's a rather elite athletic activity. But that isn't part of it. They still need river access. I still want there to be a club, and they're taking on the responsibility for being the actor. So I do think, I'm with you in that to get the public in, I think it is a sign, it is some get out the word kind of activities. Because I wasn't rowing, I was just taking my own kayak. So that's the kind of word of mouth we want out. But I don't know who would step up and be responsible for the regular key. Is it the police? Is it the DPW? Is it the rec department? And I think that's what the work it out thing is in my mind, is how does regularity work?
It sounded from what they were saying that they were three lots. One was Lane, one was somebody else. That sounds like there's no reason for Lane to have a lock. There's no, there should be one lock, and then that just leaves the question of who's got the key and who's got the responsibility, dusk and dawn, to...
I don't think you can lock Lane out of their own property at night if they want to bring in...
Right, but there's three different locks, so they can have another...
Oh, I see what you mean. Thank you. Yes. I get it. Thanks.
Sarah, do you have any clarity on this?
I think people are not sure. I think the current situation with the gate that's there, with the signage and access, is not working well. And a new gate is being sought, but I think all of these questions can be answered.
Might be a task force.
Well, I think Tony's question is a good one. You know, your comment is a good one. And I struggled when I was looking at this as to why the rowing club has any responsibility for the pavement. This was a city project. That's who we funded when we gave the money for the original paving and construction of everything for a town park and town access for residents. The rowing community was doing fundraising for Boathouse at the time that we gave the money for the paving. We didn't know what the plans were. It was a big spot on the map for them to lease and put something in there. It seems like they're being burdened with something they shouldn't be in terms of putting this application forward. I mean, I get that they're working partners and they've done a tremendous job and I love what they do. It's just, maybe they're just going to answer some questions for now.
Probably the city doesn't want to take away any funding that would go to Pulaski. You're asking for the money.
I mean, with that said, I would still be content with the gating issue because I think they need to have access, but it would have to be contingent on my perspective on agreement among the parties that it's a binding written contract or something that's recorded with the deed that binds future successors if Wayne is going to sell or this other individual is going to sell, but that it be it for a term so that we all know what it is to be negotiated at some other time, although I don't want that to happen.
But that gives me a reason to think there's a good reason to get this sort of settled now.
And you feel that 5,000 gate would do that? The proposal on the table is to fully fund at 50,000. Is there further discussion? We will be voting first on the 50,000 unless there is the maker of the motion. Is that Linda? Marlene? Devin? You could change that, I suppose, right? Is that legal?
I have amended one already tonight, but it might behoove us just to vote on the full one and see where we stand.
Okay, so the motion is 50,000 for the Connecticut River Greenway parking. Are we ready to vote? All in favor? All opposed? So 1, 2, 6, the motion fails.
I'm moving to approve $5,000 for the Connecticut River Greenway gate.
No second?
Second.
Discussion?
I think we already had a discussion.
I would propose an amendment to condition it upon, and we can figure out the language when we get out of the shopping cart, but to condition it upon the written agreement that those owners who have access to it.
Everybody agreeing to everything that we say? Yes. That's part of it? Do we have a second? Someone second? Any further discussion? All in favor? All opposed? So that's 3, 4, 5, 6 to 1. Do you get that, Sarah? All right. Academy Music curtains. Is there a motion to be made?
I would vote to fund partial funding, $46,657, which would be for the SNCC Tuttle curtain.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion?
If this had come in without that Tuttle scene, would it have been in, would we have received this project?
Would have been eligible in that chance?
Sarah?
Yeah, I'm going to smoke something.
And I don't question the need for the curtain, although I don't think it would check. Well, my understanding is right now the Academy can operate with the curtain they have until they have to use it, then all bets are off.
Mm-hmm. And they have not had to use it since it's put up in whenever 1891 or something.
So, in historic resources, under the definition of rehab and restoration, which is allowable, it's made capital improvements or extraordinary repairs to make assets functional for intended use, including improvements to comply with federal, state, or local building or access codes. So if this actually doesn't meet code, then yes.
Okay, thank you.
I was not satisfied with the answers to the questions around whether or not it meets code. I don't think they were prepared to.
I think they have an exception to meeting code is what I finally decided.
I think they had that for something else, but not for that.
But that was for not putting fire retardant on this scenic curtain to allow it to be burned on this. So, yeah. What I heard about the asbestos fire curtain was, well, no one's called us out on it, we're not reporting in on it, certainly it wouldn't be allowed if we had. So, I mean, I see that they need it, but I see that we don't have much money to spend right now.
Well, I don't think that that could be the situation, you can't run a public venue on the QT, I mean, that's just not.
So, yeah, the whole presentation to me was not, didn't make sense.
But it sounded like that's exactly what they're doing, they're making the pitch, hoping it happens, and they don't, it's not become aware that this is the circumstance and that they get a fire code violation and then they're forced to do it.
Well, I don't know that it's a QT, there's a letter from the fire chief in the package.
But that had to do with the tunnel.
It's true, it had to do with the tunnel, but then obviously they were in there looking around.
But, did they look at the fire curtain, which is all rolled up and way up there? I don't know, it hasn't been unrolled and.
Maybe if they're cited, then they'll have a strong application when they come back for it.
I mean, pardon me, it feels like with many of these projects, you have capital improvement outlay from the city, and that if this is something that needs to be repaired, that should be the first stop. And we have this issue with the academy roof when it was happening, and we were told, well, we don't fix it the way it needs to be fixed. You know, building services, we go in and do a temporary patch, and we have to get in the waiting line and everything else. But that, to me, is where they should go for the fire department. And it makes me a little uncomfortable, you know, how many disbursements have we had to the academy? And I love the academy, and I think they've done a great job using their money to bring it back up, as well as other people's money. But with the number of grants and the amount of money, again, part of what we do is say, well, you need to have the wherewithal to ensure that our investment is protected. And the best protection is having a functional fire. And all this time, they weren't aware that it wasn't functioning, nor did they tell us that it wasn't functioning, and it's been sitting out there as a potential liability. That doesn't make me feel great. And I feel like, hey, go to the city. It's a city-owned property, and do we have one to do first? But I think the tunnel is more akin to what we should be doing in terms of the community aspect. So I would look at this motion favorably.
Well, if in the package, the letter from Deborah J. Anthony to the fire chief states that as they initiated the process to treat the main curtain, they uncovered the tapestry. So, I mean, I think they were going about that on their own. And now it would be convenient to have us do that. Oh,
the main curtain is not the fire curtain.
The main curtain is not the fire.
Sorry.
The fire curtain did not come up with the fire department inspection or withdrawal or the city.
The main
order.
Rag is the
curtain.
Maybe that's why I missed it.
So it's, in terms of the fire curtain, so you know, when they were talking about it on these sort of ancient pulleys and this and that, does that mean if we don't fund it and there was a fire that it may not come down? I mean, is it not even functional? I was very confused.
I don't think they know because
it's a manual system is what they said. I assume
because they haven't taken it down. So
right.
They haven't tested it.
So you can't test it because it's got frying asbestos or perhaps.
Perhaps they don't, that was not clear to me that it was friable. They seemed to be thinking that if it came down, that it would be friable. It was not
clear. Just, I mean, it would be such a horrible scenario to have it, something happen. With it. You know, we have rejected the request for a fire curtain in favor of a scenic curtain, and then the academy goes up and smoke spouting asbestos everywhere because
there are sprinklers.
There are sprinklers, but not where we sit.
No, but the fire curtain is going to.
No, I mean, what are the chances of that happening?
Keep the fire on the stage where
right.
Most of the flammable items are from
right.
Going, and that's where the sprinklers are.
But my point is, should we be funding a scenic curtain over an asbestos-laden fire curtain that may not even work as. Just posing a question.
I think it's a good question.
Yeah, I assume the tunnel curtain will be stabilized until it's, I don't know what that involves. I assume it's still hanging on the back of the rag that they found it on.
Sarah, we typically, when we send out our questions, we have a kind of standard question. If you have received partial funding, what aspects of the project would you fund? Would that go into our Q&As? And would they specify which maybe your standard practice to send it to everybody?
We ask it in the application process.
We'll do the application.
I was just so confused when he was talking about, again, how this is, you know, on the quiet, no one knows about it. They did, they could shut us down, blah, blah, blah. It's like, what?
But you're asking publicly for CPA to go before city council.
Exactly.
It didn't seem all that above board. It was emergency and it was the first priority. I would expect them to tell us, as well as capital improvements, and make sure that they got back to time for it. They wouldn't be holding shows until it got back. I don't know. Yeah. Yes, that would feel terrible if something happened. I don't know that we would be the ones who would be liable, especially if we're only recognizing that there are problems this many years later after they've started all of their construction.
I even, now that I'm looking closely at the tunnel curtain portion of the project monies, they've got a contingency. They've got $3,000 in for lodging and meals. I don't know that I got any explanation about who's lodging and what meals.
I went through it, and made a note too about kind of the potential. They basically have certain of their staff would come down once for a period of the week, and certain of their staff would come down twice. Like they're going to do work. Something has to happen and they have to come back.
And this is most the curtain without borders, folks?
Yeah, most of them are coming from somewhere in Vermont or elsewhere in England, as best I could tell.
Okay.
If you look at it, it says some people may come the day before, or they might come early in the morning. And so it seems like for the amount of additional lodging for those people who would have to come down, if they have the ability to come that morning, well, then they don't need to stay overnight. And so just, but they also count, they double count their time in terms of the amount of time they'll be working as well as travel and travel days. And so it seems to be, the numbers seem to be a little bit inflated. So it'll be up to Sarah to monitor their invoices to make sure that they're not.
Well, and I'm hearing that some explanation for the contingency because they don't know how that will be doing.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that was just a little weird.
Other discussion?
It may be that ultimately we feel like we should fund the fire curtain, but I don't think it was an adequate presentation of the need to do that, and I'm not comfortable spending essentially $100,000.
$130,000.
Without better understanding of the need for it and the current situation. I understand it's a little delicate because if you really test it, then you may absolutely have to do it, but kind of saying, you think it's not good, therefore fund it for $130,000, whatever, it's too much money to proceed with.
Maybe they need an expert to help them figure out what to do.
So they're tying these two projects together because of the downtime and the scaffolding and the equipment that they need to do both curtains at the same time would be the efficient way to do it. So, I don't know where, if we don't give them the funds, I don't know where it's going to come from, but do they go to the city?
I mean, there's capital improvement, everything gets prioritized and things stay on that list for a very long time. But no, if it's a health and safety thing, those are the things that the process that are supposed to get elevated. And I think that's the burden on the academy to demonstrate that and build the city who takes care of the health and safety issues first. But it's a city-owned property. To me, it's the last one.
I don't understand how the fire department would come in and then not recognize that this asbestos fire curtain marginally installed was not an issue.
It may not be the fire department's responsibility to check that. It could be the fire marshal or some other group or no one. I don't know.
So we're not anxious that we're funding the wrong thing here, that we're doing the scenic curtain rather than the fire curtain. No one else is anxious.
And I think so. The other way to play it is to say, well, we like the scenic curtain, but it's hard for us to figure out what your priorities are. It would be a shame to send X amount of money into a store curtain only to have it go up in flames on the fire curtain. You know, and so we're not going to fund anything until you figure out what your own priorities are. You know, the total curtain doesn't need to go anywhere. I can see merit in both of those arguments, or just fund the total curtain.
Come back in this way.
I guess I just really feel that the presentation was not sufficient to convey the urgency. If there really was that kind of urgency, I think it would have been more thorough presentation to convince us.
So their downtime's in August, right? So would they have time to come back to us in the next round and receive money for that downtime? Is that, well, I don't know what our timeline is.
Well, we can appropriate, money can be appropriated by when? End of June, Sarah?
Mm-hmm.
So if it's August that their downtime is, then yes.
No, I mean, if you make the money available, that doesn't mean that they can necessarily secure it.
No, I see what that means. Right, if they're not going out to bid until July 1st. And then,
no, but I think that's the thing. If it was truly an emergency or it was something that was unsafe and doesn't meet code, then they wouldn't be doing anything and they would have all the downtime they need. Hard to know, but I think Linda's right. You know, the presentation wasn't good enough to, for us to thoughtfully dissect us and come to a conclusion on the other.
It was simply good enough to give me sleepless nights. Thanks a lot, Karen. Further discussion on this?
Can we take a moment to digest what we were all talking about before we go down this and talk some more about where people are living?
So remember, the proposal was to fund $46,657 for the scenic curtain only, correct? And not to fund the fire curtain replacement.
So just to throw a fly in the ointment, I realize this curtain has the most value to this theater than was in its history. But is there any other purpose? I mean, if we didn't fund the restoration of this curtain, would it be an asset that they should do something else with? Is it valuable to the theater curtains? Without orders, people. I mean, is that, in other words, what is the outcome if we don't fund this curtain? And can they explore the opportunities that they should look at or what they should do with this curtain?
That's a good question.
I don't know that we asked that directly, so it's hard to know. Yeah.
Well, and
I think there'd be one option is to leave it in place until funding is available. The sense of that is they can't transport it. Things are damn big and can't fold it and can't roll over, which is why they have to do the stuff in place.
Okay.
It probably isn't going to go anywhere. They talked about donating it, they talked about putting it in a museum, and again, because of transport, because of how big it is, no one had the ability to house it. You might have been interested in using it for this. I'm not sure that it has another place to go.
I'll take that as the answer. So my fly is out of the ointment now. It needs to stay with this theater.
My concern is that if we fund the $46,000 for the total curtain, and they say, no, we can't do it for $46,000 because we have to have special scaffolding, just, you know, we were putting the two proposals together. So if you fund that, you're not funding enough. And the way they had their budget set up, it looks like enough, but, you know, it was because the two projects were together that...
I didn't get the sense that they were interconnected. It'd be totally different people that would be doing that.
So none of the rigging or scaffolding or extra personnel?
I think certainly it's a matter of timing when it's closed.
I just don't want to, finance something that can't be pulled off with that amount of money.
I don't think that's the case.
Okay.
Based on what they say the process is, they're basically going to get a bunch of tables, fill the stage, roll the thing over, take it down, put it out, and work on it at that point. But so it's a pretty low technology operation, the way they describe it.
Further discussion? Did that help, Dave? Was that helpful to clarify, or are you still looking for clarity on what we're going
to? No, I know we're going on.
You're the one who wants the time.
Well, I figured the others can. I feel a little awkward saying. There's a potential risk of this project, and you can need to explore it. And at the same time, we're going to put more investment into the building, knowing that potentially there's a fire hazard. So, part of me feels like, all right, well, let's just wait until everything shakes out and tell the curtain's not going to disintegrate so badly in that time period that we have to worry about it. On the other hand, I feel like it's a valuable project that has the potential to add a lot to our community once it's renovated. Hopefully they can figure out their fire curtain issues in the interim, and they didn't demonstrate that it's necessarily a huge safety issue right now. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. Well, and my feeling about that is we're sitting here with Conservation Commission recommending purchase of a farm that, we know comes up rarely. So it's those kind of trade-offs. I would have a hard time funding that fire curtain and tunnel curtain and leaving that conservation land unhandled. So, we know how tight this is going to be. At one point I thought we were okay because I thought that the number we were working against was the total for our half, not for the whole year.
Right, and that's my balance. It was not to fund both curtains, but to fund no curtains, and make the money available for something else.
The curtain's been around for 102 years, correct? Made in 1913. So not funding it now does not mean that it cannot be funded in the future. It is still part of the, it's still stapled to the main drape, is that correct, folks who might?
No, it's been removed to another 2x4 that hung it in the back.
So hanging in the back, is that degraded further? Is it now, is it in danger of, once you remove it, does light come in now and do something with fabric?
It's at the back of the stage, so I don't.
So it does not seem to be a necessity of rushing into something like this. Again, I still feel uncomfortable with the priority of funding that over the fire curtain, and I feel very comfortable funding the fire curtain because the presentation was so poorly done, and it's just weird. Once again, the motion on the table is $46,657 simply for the scenic curtain. Are we ready to vote? Yes? Okay, all in favor? All opposed? So was there an abstention there? One abstention? So 1, 2, 3, 4, one in favor, 5 opposed, 1 abstention. Is that correct?
Yeah.
3, 4, 5, 6. Sarah, do you get that? Sarah, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. And we can always revisit everything, although this did not go in the shopping cart. I'm assuming that even if it doesn't, somebody doesn't go in a shopping cart, can we revisit it? What's our policy on that? I think we don't put in the shopping cart. It's not.
Well, so it's, we're getting to the end of getting late, but we, when we started, we had questions we were putting out and wanting to hear back from people, and I don't know if that might apply here, but there's something we need to hear.
And what is that something that we need?
Well, I don't know. Jack had that question, which I actually think gave an answer about, you know, the mobilization and getting it done for what they proposed. And do we, when we decline this, I think I asked this last time, we have a conversation with them, they watch the, you know, show, they hear what we said, I mean.
Are we?
I think we should convey our concerns and.
I think, I feel like they're a regular player in this whole process. They understand the process very well.
Yeah.
But I do think it would be important to convey the sense of the committee, of the confusion over the fire curtain and what that means, and I'm confused as to even how to state my confusion to them, but I think we need to come up with something, and maybe Sarah and I could work on that, of how to get back to them if in fact we don't come with what our concerns were, and encourage them to come back with, perhaps present it in a way that is more understandable.
I think that's generally the way to do it. Ideally, anyone who wants to come to us, I mean, our obligation to try to make their application as successful as possible to the community benefits. So that makes sense. I think, you know, we didn't have a full discussion about the tunnel because we were so wrapped up around fire curtain, but you know, our sense from prior conversation with the most folks around the table, I felt like this is a very worthy project in terms of what that curtain brings and how it's used and its role in the history of that theater. And I think that would be an important thing to convey. It's not that we didn't like anything, it's that we actually liked something very much, but we were concerned about, you know, what is the priority, safety or historic preservation, and how those things emerge.
Right. So you're taking notes here.
That was just my.
Yeah, I've got confusion about the tunnel curtain. Oh, what's the plan for? What, I mean, is it, it's on the tour? Is that, I mean, that's about the only sort of.
The way they describe it is there are two ways for the public to interact with it. One would be their monthly tours, which they said is that it was subscribed. And the second would be that because it's in the back and it comes down, that it can be, depending on the nature of the performance, it can be used in a drop down. And even when you like to look at it sitting in the seats, whether you're in the front or the back, it's so massive and has a presence that once it's restored, it would be a beautiful backdrop. I mean, then, you know, a really, really big show would be down and things like that, and it would be encouraged to use it. I don't know any way else for people to get in, but you know, when they have Pebble Bay, people come from far and wide.
And there actually is, I can continue this discussion even though we voted, there actually is a letter from the fire department, which I'm now remembering was even more confusing to me, which says that it's the understanding of the Northampton Fire Department that the Academy of Music intends to replace the current fire curtain, the new curtain. The Northampton Fire Department fully supports the Academy of Music in their goal to obtain the fire curtain to provide the highest level of safety and protection. It's not saying it's necessary, it's required, they're out of compliance. This is, so it's, so there's some awareness on the part of the fire department.
Yeah, I read that one while we were sitting here and thought that didn't give me any indication that the fire department was upset by what was there.
Okay, so we have not, we agreed not to put in our shopping cart for Sarah. And I will draft something that goes to the Academy trying to clarify the priorities and the fire curtain and the public and maybe we try to get that back before the meeting in 2 weeks. Good going there? The clock.
I move we approve $30,000 for the Seth Warner clock restoration.
We have a second.
Yes.
Discussion.
I'm perfectly happy to, if I know the storage of this clock is stable right now, I'm perfectly happy putting that off because its real goal is not until the park is finished.
Sarah, is there cost to storage?
Not at the present time.
Is there...
Did they draw down the $10,000 completely that we allocated for storage and costs in case costs come up in the future?
I think they were saving some of that from the moving it to the leachate plant to wherever it has to go to get there. But other than that, yeah.
And is there any worry about the people that can do this are so precious, we can't get to them, or they're dying of old age, or, you know? Is there any other time pressure on this that I wouldn't understand?
I think the time pressure is just making sure that it's done in conjunction with Pulaski Park, so that all the underground utilities and all of that good stuff can be done at the same time. And if it's unknown whether the clock will be restored, then the funds won't be there to do that.
Oh, wait a minute, the clock's not tied into the electric line?
No, it's not, but they wouldn't be able to put in a conduit or do any of the work that would require the clock to be lit in a certain place. So that while things are dug up, they're going to do it all at the same time. That's the only time constraint that we're...
That they said that all the infrastructure for the clock would be put in place, so whenever it was...
As part of the park project, or the clock?
That was in their application. But in that case...
If it's in the application, go with that.
It's not a large ticket item, and I think that I'd like to communicate to the city that we intend to fund this. We understand its purpose, it's going with the park, but that in funding $200,000 for utilities and various other projects this round, it might be better to come back to us yet again. I mean, I realize this is asking for the third round, so that's what I would propose.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like this is part and parcel of the way Wayne has been approaching us through planning, is to give us 5 or 6 applications every round, not prioritize anything, and things will all happen. So I feel like we need to apologize if this is the lowest priority, and he submits it with other priorities of his that are higher. On the other hand, I also feel like this is, you know, Pulaski Park's getting a ton of CPA money and state money. There's not been a lot of fundraising, and I think, and as much as we don't have a lot of people coming in, there's been a lot of activity getting it where it needs to go since like 2006 or 2007, and long before that, people were definitely interested. But there isn't a fundraising component, and I feel like there might be a Pulaski Park dedication and people will come, but there isn't anything to feel ownership of. And this, yeah, reminds me of Back to the Future, when the clock tower went, that big lightning strike, and then they go back in time and do it all over again. At that point, the mayor of the town was raising money for the clock tower. And this is a great opportunity for people to get engaged and feel ownership. And I would like to see more than a minor contribution for this $30,000, given that we paid for the purchase and we paid for the transport, you know, 10 or 15 grand with the public support. You know, if they want to put advertising on the top, it's consistent, if it's historical.
No, we just took that off.
Put on it anyway. Who wants to fund it? But I mean, there's ways to get the community involved.
Yeah, that's a good point. There just isn't any fundraising. It was back when the CPA first started, there was a lot more fundraising.
Well, a solution would be to partially fund, and with the condition that the rest be made up in private donations.
I would say, until the next round, to give Wayne the indication that, you know, it would be nice to see it. For some aspect of the park, see it funded. I mean, I can see it would be weird to say, we need money for this $1 million prop, give us $10. But for a clock, where you can see the contribution going in its hand around.
And I would say, if I was sitting in Wayne's seat, I'd do the same thing. He's got this committee, we debate the priorities. I can't fault him for having us do that. Now, that's, and we're coming from different, you know, backgrounds with different interests, you know.
All right, thousand for it? I mean, he wouldn't be doing his job if he didn't do it. I just don't feel like we need to apologize if something falls out of 2 rounds. We'll feel bad.
You know, I've stated my opposition to this damn clock over and over and over. We've purchased it. We've spent money to purchase it.
we spent money to store it, and now we're not spending money to fix it? I mean, am I gonna be the only one voting for it? No, seriously, I mean, this is like, oh my God. At some point, you know, we bought it, we're storing it, and now we're just gonna say, well, yeah, we can do it.
It was, my punting it off to another time was also looking at all these other things that had, and there were some places that needed to be some give, depending on, you know, to really add up what we've come up with is about half of the...
Could we do a quick add right now, Sarah? Would that be all right?
Things recommended so far?
Correct, yeah.
$429,310.
$429?
And that's not including this motion for the fund.
So $429 out of the $871, which is our minimum.
Yeah.
And can I just make the point that if the pot needs to be restored by the time we do the second round, I don't see saving the money and voting then as opposed to now. So if we're talking about we'll get to it, then in my mind we're getting to it in the next funding year, not in the next round.
Motion to fund the clock.
If we already have one on the floor.
That makes sense.
So
we already have them.
Timing wise, I just want to make sure we understand that if the park is done, you know, in the spring and the clock is not restored, then it doesn't come to the opening, it doesn't serve its purpose. So Brian has got my attention as we move through the matter.
Sarah, can you do the math one more time? I'm confused.
So it's $200,000 for plastic park, $131,310 for historic dark campus, $90,000 for the Rocky Hill connector, $359,000.
That's after 9, so the decimal points start moving. So 459,000 out of 871, that leaves us with whatever that is. What is it, 400,000, 400 something?
420.
420? Okay. Plus the one, what is it, 35 with affordable housing that we have in reserve. So that is useful to know that. We're back to the motion on the table, which is to fully fund the clock at 30,000.
Dave, I want to say I'm really going to miss your voice and perspective and insight and input when you're gone. I think it's really valuable and unique, and you always bring things forward that I haven't even thought about yet.
He's also got a really good memory.
And he's got a great memory. But I love the idea of having this that we have to fundraise, but at the same time I also see the value of just finishing this and having it there when the park is there. So I think at this point I would vote in favor of 30,000 to finish the clock project.
Okay, I'll just chime in, and I appreciate your comment.
Chime in?
I'm not convinced that Pulaski Park will finish on time. I'm not convinced that, I mean, I'd like it to be, but I mean, if that's what we're gauging, we need to have a clock ready for the opening. That to me is there are no influence there. The reason why we built into the plan that they would have the infrastructure is the reality that the clock may not be ready or other things may not be ready. And the clock can go in whenever the clock is right. Is it $80,000 or $90,000 project altogether with, you know, with $500 worth of donated time for someone from DPW to wind it every year, and everything else is paid for by us? There's no aspect of Pulaski Park that has any contribution from anybody else other than taxpayers. And I just think that's
votes on the project, that was one of our considerations, is it would be really nice. Now, is it essential? Maybe not, but I feel like compared to the rest of the projects on there, you know, I'd rather give historical Hampton more money for the bar and get it done than I would dig out from the Clapham. You know, and so.
I just changed.
Ranked as 7 and 8 for everybody. Is it chunk change? I don't know. I just thought it's the highest priority now.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Further discussion? Are we set to vote? So the motion on the table is to fully fund $30,000 for the Seth Warner clock. All those in favor? All those opposed? So the motion fails 2-5, is that correct? Great, which leaves us in the shopping cart of $459,000-something. I will suggest that we sleep on this or sit on this for a couple of weeks. Does that make sense? And that we come back and attempt not to revisit any of these discussions in too great detail, although we can do whatever we want. We are asking that that Jim come for Pulaski, is that correct? And not, and that Historic Northampton simply respond in writing to the to Evans Joyce, Barnes Joyce concern, but not to come specifically. But we would like Jim to come, or can we get Jim in writing as well?
I asked him to come. It seems like that might be.
Okay.
Just
so Jim coming.
There's enough things that seem like I'm doing.
Historic Northampton in writing. We have, you'll remember our shopping cart, yes?
Mm-hmm. And I'll send out draft council resolution.
Great. Good. And perhaps our homework can be, and I think we've done a lot of this, is to come up with the conditions so that when we are voting, going through the checkout line, that they are with conditions and that we are aware of what those are coming in. And we'll celebrate both Marlene and Dave's last time with us. And, yes. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Second.